Now we are essentially wrapping up, have some 20-ish minutes to go. And to help me shed some light on this, I would invite Øystein and Hugo to join me.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Jacob.
Hi, Øystein. Hi, Hugo. So, this is slightly different from what we've done now in the last an hour and a half. No slides, no sort of strong one-sided message. We are essentially trying to wrap our heads around all of what has been presented, and I would recognize that quite a lot has been presented and shared. So maybe we can just start with each of you reflecting overall on the key takeaways. Hugo, maybe you wanna start.
Yeah, no, with pleasure. I think that one of the key takeaways, or you could start with the fact that we are having this this presentation. I think that 2020 was definitely a turning point and an accelerator of the focus that people will put on decarbonization, which is something good, and it's something that Euronav and many people in this forum should embrace and are embracing. The second point is that when you are doing this kind of big transition, what is extremely important for people like us who have to make a lot of change and a lot of new investments is to ensure some sort of a good level playing field. Of course, whilst we welcome all the regulations, I think that it's very important to try to harmonize them. Otherwise, it's very difficult to know in which direction we should go. So that's a little bit for the global framework. Then obviously we have had a specific focus on green bonds, but I think the same could be also be told about any capital providers. We are a public company, so obviously we discuss with a lot of investors worldwide. So Europe is probably a little bit ahead of the pack in their demands for more ESG criteria. The US is following very closely, and I'm sure that with the new president, it will, or it's likely to take an acceleration. And quite frankly, the last message that I've seen coming from Asia are very encouraging as well. So let's not forget that when China will decide to board that train, they will probably overtake all of us in no time, which is also very good. So when it comes to how do you assess those criteria, I think we're getting away from greenwashing, and that's extremely good, because I would say that in the past I've seen some green bonds being labeled green, whereas I had more than my doubts, let's put it this way. And I think that's very good. And going forward, I would like for the incentive to be a little bit bigger. In fact, I mean, I'm not sure we've seen it with Hotfield, but we've signed a sustainability-linked loan with banks, and we see the difference in margin between being called sustainable or not. It was 5 basis points, so obviously that's not going to spin the world around. And that's a pity, because I think it's extremely important to recognize the ones that are doing an effort. They're doing an effort ahead, usually, of the regulation, and therefore are not really compensated on the commercial side by it. It's just their reputation, which is very important, and then the desire of their clients to be associated in their supply chain with people who are doing that effort. But it's not enough. So I would like the spread to become a lot bigger. And then the second thing is, I would like to tell the investors, whether they're bond investors or equity investors, that make absolutely no mistake. If you stop investing today in fossil fuel, you will only make the transition more expensive. And what I mean by that is obviously talking about Euronav as a company. I'm sure that Øystein is fully in agreement with me that what the EU is trying to do, and certainly on the taxonomy, eliminating ships that can transport fossil fuel is a big mistake. And so please, investors, don't do the same mistake. If our cost of capital is going up, then the cost of the transition will go up. And that's not what we want. We want to accelerate the transition.
Thank you for that, Hugo. I think a lot of relevant points that we can go into in a bit. But Øystein, I want to give you a chance to reflect on the day as well.
Yeah, thanks. I think the most immediate reflection is the fact that I thought we had enough acronyms in finance, but it seems like we need another one because SLB has always been sale and leasebacks in my world. So, so too bad, it seems like we need more. But in general, I totally agree with what you, Hugo, is saying, and in regarding to EU taxonomy, because what we are doing in Flex is, of course, we actually had a delivery of our 12 ships this night. So all our ships are extremely efficient. So compared to the ships which were steaming around when the baseline were 2008, these ships are reducing the carbon emission by 50-60%. So they're much more efficient, they are larger, and the propulsion system is they have a thermal efficiency of 50%+ rather than 35%, which you have on the mention. And then, of course, the cargo we are transporting is basically a replacement of coal. So then you're also reducing the carbon emission by 50%, but maybe more importantly, you are reducing local air pollution. And this is a big problem because on an annual basis, there's like 7 million people dying prematurely because of air pollution. And that's 7 million. That's 2 million people who have died from COVID. So this is a huge problem where, of course, switching to natural gas that burns clean are also reducing, you know, all these toxic emissions. So I do think that, you know, there need to be some work done here because you're just penalizing people who are trying to make a contribution to actually, it seems like some people think that it's not a transition. It's just switch on, switch off. Suddenly you switch off all the fossil fuels and you switch on all the renewables, but all the renewables are intermittent. So you need a transition, and you also need some baseload in the future. And the two only sources of baseload we have today is natural gas, coal, and nuclear. And all of these are not within inside the EU taxonomy. But hydrogen is, of course, inside. And how do you make hydrogen? Coal and natural gas, 90%. So, and in the future, probably most of the hydrogen and ammonia will be made from natural gas, but natural gas is not included. But then, of course, the solutions they say is, well, you will have to use carbon capture to make the ammonia and the hydrogen. But why don't you might as well just burn the natural gas and carbon, capture the carbon on the power plant? You have obtained the same result, and you don't need to change all the infrastructure. So there are some kind of logical discrepancy with the taxonomy where I don't think there's been made too much common sense, but where people are just a bit too religious about what they're trying to achieve.
Clearly, I think it's fair to say that when you go into a discussion like this and in a sector like this, that there are very complex and different perspectives as well in terms of how to approach this. But maybe if I can get you both a bit back to some of the core aspects of the discussions today, which are sort of the relevance of the financial markets in this. I think Katie, representing an investor earlier today, said that they very much look at both the proceeds but also the company. And Hugo, you mentioned as well something around really making sure that the ones making the change are allowed to make that change. And Øystein, you're sort of indirectly commenting on that as well. So with this said, do you think that the financial markets have gotten it entirely wrong maybe, but do you think there's a way for both parties to meet and actually agree on this? Because I suppose that's really what we're trying to achieve either with green bonds or sustainability linked bonds, is it's to come up with a structure that somehow gets both parties to the table and can agree on the sort of positive impact on this. Do you see that being relevant as it is today, or do we need to put our thinking hats on it a little bit better?
Well, I would think that there are today not enough people in the investor world, be it bond or equity, potentially also in the banking side, that are really thinking about what they are doing and the consequences of it. So they are scratching the surface and they are ticking the box, which is probably a first step. But I would agree with a lot of what Øystein has said. What's the purpose of having ammonia on board ships if they are brown? If it's brown ammonia, if it's produced with something that is being called completely disgusting and not touchable. I mean, that's ridiculous. We are all in favor to have ships running on green ammonia. Is that possible? And how long will it take for the infrastructure to be in place? I don't know. And I say green ammonia, it could be green hydrogen, but it's a little bit the same problem. So I think that people have to realize that we cannot produce miracle overnight, and that you need to support the champions, which are the people who are committed to the transition. And I think that with and again, Øystein makes a good point that we have now been sort of populated with a new series of acronyms, and we need to get familiar with those. But I think that some of them are very relevant. They are not very difficult to understand. And obviously the people who are publishing that on an annual basis, and Euronav is certainly one of those companies publishing like Otfiel, its carbon footprint and also its efficiency ratio already for 3 or 4 years, are the ones who are committed and who have decided to be completely transparent, have set their ambition, and will or are soon to reveal the pathway to that ambition. And that's what we are asking the investors in the market to do, is please go a little bit underneath the surface, find the champions and support them.
And maybe if I can just pick you up on that, and sort of the part of the day as well really has been obviously discussing sustainability linked bond structures. Does it seem to you maybe that is a structure that gets you a bit closer to each other, or at least allow you to see a little bit more eye to eye to each other, in that you can say, well, actually, what we're looking at are AER numbers or EEOI numbers, as Gustav and Lily also discussed. Do you think that that's something that you would be comfortable in connecting to your financing, whether in a loan or a bond?
Well, we're definitely using that already. So the last facility we raised was 713 million. So it's the largest facility that we have at the moment at Euronav. And it has a link to sustainability in the sense that it's Poseidon principle approved, and the margin will vary, as I said, unfortunately, only by 5 basis points, but will vary according to our own targets, which are more ambitious than the Poseidon principle, which themselves are more ambitious than the IMO. So we're definitely there. It is a very good way to get around with people who are interested in helping the transition, sitting at the same table. That's very true. But again, today we do it for the show, because 5 basis points is not going to allow us to develop the company further and to push the transition further. So I would like it to be a big differentiator tomorrow.
Øystein, can I pick you up on that, both in terms of the relevance of these KPIs? Now, Hugo mentioned that Euronav had taken a slightly different approach than the AER or EIO numbers. Your reflections on sort of what would be relevant for a company such as Flex to look at, but also on this discrepancy on basis points, whether it's 5 basis points or it should be more. What's your thoughts on those things?
I think today, of course, a lot of the kind of sustainability linked in terms of loans. We did a 639 million ECA financing for 5 of 4 ships, and the ship we took delivery of tonight was 125 million loan. Bank loan, both these loans are linked to the Poseidon principles. And I think in terms of, we didn't really get any benefit from pricing. So in terms of the benefit from pricing, we got it through demand for the loan. So when we did the 639 million loan, this was well above $1 billion subscribed from banks. So of course there was an ECA part there of $380 million and then $250 million in for banks, and that was well subscribed. So in that relation, we were able to pressure the price, but we didn't really have a linking to the price. So I do think that, you know, it just gives you more access if you can prove that you are doing something. And we are also publishing our ESG report. So our third ESG report will come out in April. I think one of the problems actually when I've looked at these sustainability linked bonds is there's a lot of focus on carbon emission reductions, and you seem to have like a pathway of reductions, and for us that's a bit of a problem because we have leapfrogged, so we have already done that reduction, as I mentioned and highlighted the fact that there's a lot of steamships around that are consuming 50 to 60% more fuel per kind of ton mileage. So the carbon intensity target is reducing it by 70% by 2050 compared to 2008, and we are already close to achieving that target in 2021. So we are not, you know, just a shade away from that target already. So that means, of course, there are limitations to how much more we can reduce it. But having that kind of pole position makes me very confident that we will be able to meet the targets well ahead of 2050, because we will invest in newer ships, which will be on average slightly more efficient and bring down the emissions for our fleet. So I think there are, you know, there should be some kind of focus on levels, not only on the rate of change.
And I think that's a very important point. We are getting close to the hour, so I want to inspire us to think about 1 year ahead when we then have hopefully the follow-up to this inaugural event. Clearly that's a topic for us to go into, and it does clearly seem to be broadly a topic but also an industry that we'll see a lot of change over the next couple of months. I think certainly we'll hope to see that with regards to the sustainable finance developments. And I think it's fully recognized that industry leaders might scratch their head and think, well, you're saying one thing, but the money doesn't show the same. So I think that's also fair perhaps to reflect that that's something that the industry in its entirety, the financial markets, will need to address. Maybe just sort of wrapping up, and a quick one to both of you. Let's say we fast forward the clock 1 year, and obviously we have a Biden administration that will have been here for 1 year. We'll have had one more year to work with things. Will things look different in terms of how we're thinking about this, in terms of how you are engaging with the investors? Would you expect that we are continuing the same sort of struggle a bit with some of the leading owners and operators saying one thing and the investors still saying, no, this is the way we want to go about it? Do you think that will be the case, or do you foresee something slightly changing?
Well, I believe that the as I said, I mean, 2020 was an accelerator. I think that 21, and certainly with the new US administration, will continue that acceleration. I always make the same analogy. Up until 2019, it was very rare when we had our earnings call that we had a questions about ESG, whether it's E, the E, the S, or the G. And I would say that in 2020, there wasn't any earnings call where we didn't have a question. And in the follow-up calls with investors, so not only with analysts, but investors, I think that a good 50% of them are included ESG questions. I expect that to accelerate. I expect to have probably 80% of the calls with the investors where at least one of the questions would be on ESG. And it's always the same. We're there to do a job. So our job is not to do ESG, but the way we do our job is with our ESG criteria. So it cannot be the dominating factor. There is still economic underlying, which is very important, but the way you do it obviously has to be done in the proper way, and you have to have a good governance, you have to have a good social view on what you're doing for your communities, for the people that you employ, and then obviously for the environment, which is where all eyes are open. It is very important to be transparent and to do something about it.
Thank you for that, Hugo. And Øystein, any final reflections to that as well?
I hope with the Biden administration that we could rather move in the direction of more of a global price on carbon, because I think we are business people. We much rather prefer market and market incentives rather than a lot of detailed regulation. So I think you can achieve a lot more with a global price of carbon. And then, you know, for those people, those countries who are not willing to be part of that system, then there will be a border adjustment tax. So I think just implementing that will do a lot more for the industry than all the EU taxonomy and regulations that are micromanaging decisions. If you have a price, those people reducing their emissions will get rewarded by making a better profits, while those people not adapting will die. So I hope that we can move a bit more in the progress that the market takes more of a role rather than regulators.
Fully agree.
Very good. With that level of agreement and inspiration, thank you, Hugo, and thank you, Øystein, for taking the time to be with us today. And I also want to thank all the other participants who spent time with us this morning, and certainly all of you participants who've chosen to dial in. And as we've talked about the new presidency, obviously today is the inauguration. So best of luck to them and to us all. Have a wonderful day and have a wonderful 2021.
Thank you so much, Jacob.
Yeah.